pick February for this talk.
Deliberate. It was not accidental.
Now, if we'd been able to schedule it on Wednesday, we would have been even better.
But no.
The best we could do.
That's good.
So we're going to talk about the machine. Now, like I said, I'm going to mostly talk about more the technical side of it. So I'm not going to be talking as much about the circumstances and the people as you might hear in a lot of other accounts. But at the same time, I do want to talk a little bit, just kind of bring everyone up to speed on some of the basic ideas and motivations of the thing. This is probably the most famous photograph of the ENIAC. If I'm not mistaken, this was part of the press release when they first announced it. And the machine in this picture, you can't really see it too well, but it goes all the way back into this room. And this is a picture that was taken at the University of Pennsylvania where it was built. We're going to talk about some of the other parts of it a little bit later, but in this picture there's a couple of bits I want to highlight. You see a couple of people standing in front of these panels here. There were three of those panels, and they were covered with hundreds of rotary switches. The intent of that, by the way, originally was to put tables of information. If you need sines and cosines, you would dial them in, one digit at a time. That was the easy part of programming, was dialing those in one digit at a time. The other thing that I want to highlight in this picture, because it won't show up in the simulator, is over here we have good old classic punch card equipment. No study of computing is complete without punch cards. These, in fact, were standard IBM punch card devices. They decided rather than trying to build anything from scratch, it was a lot easier just to buy off-the-shelf IBM equipment. Plus, this was being done for the Army in Aberdeen, Maryland, and they already had a large installation of punch card unit record equipment. So they were all set to be able to handle the input and output. And that's all the I.O. there was on this machine. No keyboard, no mouse, no touch panel, not even a printer. And so these are the printer and punch that are sitting over there. So what is this thing? Well, it was built for the Army in World War II. Now the motivation was, okay, war's going on, our military manufacturers are building new guns, new shells, new explosives to fire them. But we've got to be able to tell the folks in the field how to point the gun. We've got to go through all the calculations to figure out how this thing's going to travel. So if I'm going to try to shoot at them over there, I know to point the gun that way. Well, the amount of calculation that was needing to be done was just overwhelming the Army. In 1942, driven by interest not only in Army-related things, but in weather prediction and a number of other things, John Mauchly had written a proposal that was circulated around Penn saying, hey, I bet we could build a really fast, big machine to do these calculations. In 43, he and Presper Eckert revised it into a proposal for the Army where they let the contract for initially a 6-month contract to see how it was going to go. By the time the 6 months was over, they had a fair amount to show for it, and the Army said, go for it, here, have some money. World War II, the Army has lots of money, so they said, here, have some. Have some more. The usual way contracts go. By the time it was over with, they had spent close to $500,000.
Wow.
Which, in World War II terms, wasn't too bad, considering what the Manhattan Project was costing. So it was built during World War II, but it really didn't ever get finished in time to help with the artillery calculations for the war itself. It was pretty much up and running full capability by the winter of 1945. By then, of course, the war was over, but the folks at Los Alamos were just getting started. And in fact, they ran one of the first big jobs on it in the winter of 45. It was then dedicated in 46. As I said, yesterday was the anniversary of that. Later in 46, it was shut down at Penn to be moved to Aberdeen, started back up there in 47, and retired in 1955. Retired being a good euphemism for dismantled and hauled out back. Most of the parts of it do still exist. Not in running condition, though. But there are various displays of it. There are those of us who think that the right thing to do, though, is to bring it all back to Philadelphia and put it together again. If you would like to fund that, I'll be glad to talk to you afterwards. Now, the other thing is that from the very beginning, the intent was to do a lot more than just artillery calculations. In fact, even before the machine went into operation, the Army set up a board whose purpose was to accept requests for time on the machine and to figure out how to allocate it. And over its lifetime, these are just some of the things that it got used for. Several different calculations for Los Alamos and atomic bomb development. Obviously, the ballistic trajectories that were the original purpose. There's a neat number theory problem that was worked on in 1946 related to prime numbers. And some weather prediction. And I think I had to cut it off to make it fit on the slide, but it was also used for developing some of the earliest supersonic aircraft, particularly in terms of simulating the airflow over the wings. So it was used for all sorts of stuff, and really was, for several years, the only major high-speed, large-scale computing device in the US. And so they were very busy taking requests for time on it and figuring out who would get priority. Now, these are the two guys behind it. I've mentioned their names already. The one on the left here is John Malkley. He came to Penn from Ursinus College. He was a consultant for the Army and doing all sorts of interesting things. And as I said, one of his real big interests was weather prediction. And you know what weather prediction is like today. Imagine what it was like when the only calculation you had available was a marchant machine on your desk. So he was very interested in trying to do better weather prediction, as well as other kinds of calculations. When he came to Penn, Eckert was, I think, had just graduated with his master's in electrical engineering. And they found that they had similar interests. And from what I can tell, obviously I never knew either one of them, but from what I can tell, they were the kind of intellectual pair that complemented each other in just the right way. That as a partnership, they were like almost inseparable. Eckert was the engineering mind, and Malkley was the one who saw how and why we would want to use it and how. And putting those together was how they ended up with the kind of machine they did. Now, inevitably, there's lots of wonderful statistics that you have to have about a machine like this. For example, if you were to stretch it all out, it would be a wall 8 feet tall and 80 feet long. Now, it was normally arranged in a horseshoe, so that the space within the horseshoe was 32 by 16 feet. You literally could walk around in the computer. In fact, toward the end of its life, people began to move their desks into the room and use it as an office, mostly because it was the only air-conditioned room around. There's, the wonderful statistic about 18,000 vacuum tubes. Substantially larger than anything that had ever been built before or since. There has never been anything with 18,000 vacuum tubes other than the ENIAC. This thing was enormous. We're all used to multi-gigahertz clocks these days. The ENIAC had this enormously fast clock of 100 kilohertz.
Yay.
And as we're going to see, actually, that was a little too fast and they had to slow down some. 20 of the cycles of that basic clock would go into the core operations, and so they would refer to that as an addition time. which meant that you could do an addition in 200 microseconds. Obviously, that means you can do 5,000 additions per second.
That's
well, kind of. On this machine, you could actually do, theoretical peak, 100,000 additions a second. It was a much more parallel machine than most people are aware of. I love this figure, 150 kilowatts of power.
Yeah.
You know, like several radio stations worth of power.
Yeah.
When I first came to Drexel, people would tell me stories. I think they're probably apocryphal, I don't know for sure. But I kept hearing stories about how the lights in Philadelphia would dim when they powered the machine up. I don't know how many of you are power supply designers, but that right there, for a primarily digital guy, 78 distinct DC voltages kind of scares me, especially when most of them are several hundred volts. This was a complex machine. It had its own heat sensors to detect overheating for fire and shut things down. It had sensors on every door so that you couldn't operate for very long with the panels removed. Unless, of course, they defeated them. And then caught on fire. Right before they gave it to the Army. So the net effect of that was the Army said, oh, well, we're not going to turn it off at night. Well, but we are going to turn it off at night now, since it was a fire. Well, turning off tubes is the surest way to make sure that they don't last long.
With 18,000 tubes, did they have any special way to find out if one or more went bad and where they were?
Yes. One of the things we're going to see a little bit later is that everything was built into modules that they had duplicates of. And so once you could narrow down the fault to a module, you could swap in a replacement and then take that off to the bench and diagnose the actual problem. So it kept the downtime manageable. You know, it's one of those things that when they first proposed this thing, and the very first proposal only had 5,000 tubes, everybody in the industry told them, you are insane, the machine won't stay up more than a few minutes at a time. That's part of where Eckert's genius came in. He developed design techniques to extend the life of these cubes because he understood what the failure modes were and how to account for them. For example, he would run them at a lower than specified filament voltage to reduce the amount of heat and therefore thermal stresses that would be involved. He was extremely meticulous about the design of the circuitry to allow for all of the components to be at the worst possible end of their tolerance range, and then some. And recognizing that as cubes age, their gain drops off. He counted that into the design as well. So it was all built around the idea that this is going to be hard to keep running, so reliability is the number one concern.
How long is it able to operate without going down?
At different points in its life, there were times when it could run for days at a time without any issues. In fact, there have been a number of problems run on it that took days to run. And so the biggest downtime related to those was the setup time. Depending on what part of the, sort of what phase of the history of it you're looking at, you would see statistics anywhere from 20 to 80% of the actual time was doing calculations. Any other questions? Yes?
Is there, in that time frame, was there military-grade electronics, or hadn't that been established yet?
Not exactly, and especially for vacuum tubes. These were, pretty much vacuum tubes were vacuum tubes at that time. Now, they did, I think, have access to military contractors for things like connectors, and they probably took advantage of that. But things like the resistors and capacitors and so on, I don't know that they made any distinctions at that time. That's before my time. I was not alive during the ENIAC. Yes.
So if you have a several day computation that can fail in the middle,
mm-hmm.
was there some way of it recording its state?
Well, typically what you would do in a case like that is design it so that you would dump the intermediate results to cards. So
okay.
that if you had to, you could go back and pull them up. And it wasn't unusual to actually have the computation itself designed in such a way that you had to go through that cycle. That is, you would run, a good example is some of the atomic bomb simulations. You would run a slice of time that would take as input cards the neutrons that were currently moving in the matrix.
Mm-hmm.
When it was done, it would output a set of cards with the new set of neutrons. And then you would take those, feed them back in the machine, and start over again. As we'll see in a minute, the machine had very little in the way of data storage available. So you had to organize it around that kind of a cycle. So with that happening, then you sort of automatically had a little bit of a backup. Yeah.
Did Weinheimer ever do anything with the ENIAC? Well, I'm curious about the interactions with the Institute for Advanced
yes.
Study. And
that, I think I'm going to address that a little bit later. In particular, he played a part in the, I mentioned on this slide here, this conversion to what amounts to an instruction set processor. He played a role in that. But it's a long enough story, I want to save it till a little bit later. Okay. So rather than read through all the details of what is in it, I'm just going to first show you this diagram straight from the original technical manuals. This is how it looked at the Moore School. And I specifically say at the Moore School because when they reinstalled it at Aberdeen, they rearranged it a little bit. And what we're going to look at next is what you would see if you were standing here looking in. And the perspective you would get would look something like this, where you've got 32 feet of racks on each side, and then across the back, 16 feet. In the real room in Penn, there were several large columns in the way, so all the pictures have bits of it being blocked by that. I've left out the roll-around switch tables so that you can see better. The other thing is that when it was moved to Aberdeen, the ceiling, of course, had its own lighting and air handling system. But the actual texture of the floor and the ceiling are taken from photographs that were taken to Aberdeen. Now, to quickly go around the machine and take a look at the different pieces of it, we're going to start on the left and kind of work our way around. The leftmost unit is called the initiating unit. That took care of the power sequencing. You hit one button and it would sequence about a minute's worth of power steps before the whole system was up. You also had a button over here that was called the initiating button. You push that to start a calculation. That's the enter key, I guess. The next unit is the cycling unit. Generates all the clock signals throughout the machine. In fact, this little plaque here shows what all the clock signals should look like. And this oscilloscope lets you look at all the clock signals. You've got a switch right here that you can select which clock signal you're looking at, and it pops up on the scope so you can see whether or not the right signal has appeared. The next two bays here are what are called the master programmer. And we'll talk about those in a little bit more detail in a bit. This double bay right here is one of three function tables. That's the part of the electronics that connects to the wheel around switch units. Then we have a couple of accumulators over here. In the next section, they're all accumulators except this one right here, which is the divider square rooter. Yeah.
What are the look like bus bars?
Yes. So the bars going across the top would carry data buses, basically. Each one of these bars would carry 11 lines, which would represent 10 digits in a sign. And they would be patched into these upper connections on the accumulators. The ones along the bottom are 11 individually accessible lines, and they were used for control pulses. And they would get patched to connections along the bottom of the units.
Yeah. So this was a decimal versus a binary?
It was decimal, yes. Everything was done in base 10, partly because they could get that working as quickly as they could do anything else. And for the war effort, getting it done quickly was very, very important. And so decimal was the safe and easy way to go. The other thing is they did do a few calculations, and based on the kind of techniques they were planning to use, they actually expected a binary machine was going to end up taking more tubes. So the decimal machine made a lot of sense at that point. Along the back wall, more accumulators, and these three units right here are the high-speed multiplier. This machine could do several hundred multiplications a second. And actually, that statistic is what got von Neumann's attention. Coming around the right side, we've got four more accumulators, two more of the function table units, and then finally, the last couple of accumulators. These three bays right here are what are called the constant transmitter. They also handle the reading of punch cards. And then the last three are the card punch. All right. So just a quick word on some of the unusual things about it when we think about it from today's point of view. The big thing is there's no memory. If you counted as I was going around, or if you remember from another slide, there were 20 accumulators. That's all the volatile memory you had. So I want you to put yourself into a position where you're writing your code with only 20 variables. That's it. Unlike the sort of machines we're used to today, there wasn't really a separation between computation and storage. The additions and subtractions were taking place in the accumulators where the numbers were being stored. Divider square rooter wasn't perfectly exact. There were definitely cases where it would produce something that was off in the least significant digit. I love this quote by Lemmer. Lemmer is the one who did that number theoretic problem I mentioned. He took advantage of the parallelism in the machine in doing that. He managed to find prime numbers by testing them in parallel against all the divisors. So he really liked that aspect of the machine. When it went to the sort of sequential instruction set processing type of machine, of course, the parallelism went away. So as far as he was concerned, von Neumann spoiled it. So let's see. The cycling unit, like I said, has a bunch of different phases. We've got a scope for monitoring it. One of the interesting things that happened was once they moved it to Aberdeen, it wasn't running all that stably, and they actually got to run a lot better by dropping it from 100 kilohertz to 60 kilohertz. And I've often wondered what exactly they did on that, because did they go in and actually change the circuitry inside, or did they take advantage of an external clock input that it had? Because you could plug an external clock in and run it at a different rate. The other thing I really like is this. You had three clock modes you could choose from. You could run it continuously. You could do it so that at a button push, you could get one of those add times, one of those 200 microsecond cycles, or for each button push, you could get one of the 100 kilohertz pulses. They had already planned for single-stepping debugging. In fact, they had already begun using the term breakpoint. Because of the way the control is done, it's all going from signal to signal. If you just pull out the plug, you break the chain, and that's a breakpoint. Now, this is what you could carry around with you to do the debugging. Whoa. This is the only photograph I've been able to find of this device. It's in the drawings, And in the drawings, there's actually a pilot light up here to tell you the machine's on. But this toggle switch right here lets you select those three modes. And then the buttons, you've got a button for clearing the machine, one for reading a card, one for doing the same as the initiate button on the initiating unit, and then the pulse button that lets you single step it. And this thing's got a cable on it that's long enough that you can carry it around the whole room and stand in front of any unit and watch what's happening. I think that has to be one of my favorite parts of the whole machine. Very cool. And like I said, I haven't ever found but this one photograph of it. Okay, so here's the clock signals. I'm not going to go through all of it in any great detail, but I do want to point out one thing. This group right here, called 1P, 2P, 2 prime P, and 4P, those are used to construct numbers. Numbers are represented, digits are represented unary. That is, a 5 is represented as 5 pulses. How do I get those 5 pulses to start with? Like if I'm reading from a punch card or something. Well, they essentially represented everything with 4 bits in places where they needed to generate a digit. And those 4 bits selected those 4 sets of pulses. So to get a 5, you could have the 1P and the 4P, and that would give you your 5 pulses. The 1 prime P down here, we'll talk about in a minute, is used for negative numbers. We'll cover those in a little bit. And that right there, that central programming pulse stuck way out there on this little lonesome, is the heartbeat of the machine. That's the pulse that came through and triggered each operation that was taking place. Now, the accumulators. Like I said, digital, decimal. 10 digits plus a sign. Now, here's the interesting thing. It wasn't stored in terms of negative numbers as sign magnitude. It was sign and tens complement. So unlike the way we do with twos complement, where you only get half the range, you got the full 10-digit range, both positive and negative. So you had a sign and you had 10's complement representation. 5 inputs for each accumulator, labeled by the first 5 letters of the Greek alphabet. The 2 outputs are A and S for add and subtract. Essentially what happens is when you're doing an output, as we'll see, the actual value of the accumulator is sent out the A side, and then its complement is sent out the S side. And for each accumulator, there were 12 different programs you could put onto it. Now, their term for program is a little different than our concept of a program. For them, the program was an operation that was performed on the accumulator. It's more similar to our modern concept of an instruction. And you could select those options, that is one of the inputs, the outputs, or 0. You might wonder, why do they have a no op? I'll explain in a minute. There's a clear correct that you can do and a repeat. On some of the inputs, some of the programs, you could actually say, I want this to repeat several times. So if I needed to sum in 5 times that value, I didn't have to invoke the multiplier. I just said, tell the other one to send 5 times, and I'll receive it 5 times. And that added in 5 times the value. That is a digit. This is 1 digit of the machine. For scale, this is about, that's not too far from life size. It's somewhere around 3 to 4 feet long. These little lighter colored buttons, it looks like there, are neon lights that show you the current value of the digit. We have 10 here representing the value 0 to 9, and then this one right here for carry. Because obviously if I'm adding pulses to a digit and it goes from 9 back to 0, I've got to carry over to the next digit. And that's exactly the way this machine works. This is the a simplified version of the schematic of it. The basic stages here are the typical cross-connected triodes that make up a flip-flop. Hmm. They're arranged so that when I get a pulse, if this one is what's activated, then it turns off and this one turns on and so on. It's just a ring counter. Okay? And ring counters are not unknown at this time. Hmm. They're building technology that they know they can get it to work. What's not shown here, of course, is that when I'm coming from the 9 back around to the 0, I've got a set of carry. That's easy enough. But now here's the interesting question. How do I read out what's in it? Because if I need to add this number to another number, I've got to somehow or another read it out and turn it into a number of pulses to send. That was a little different than the other uses of these things. Because typically what would happen is, these would be sitting on a panel, and the lights would light up, and a human would read it. But we're not interested in a human reading it. We want to send the number to another accumulator. So it's really kind of clever. This is one of my favorite design elements of it. The idea is, okay, say this is my ring counter here. If I put 10 pulses into it, wherever I'm currently located in here, that is whichever one of these digit values is on, I'm going to go all the way around and come right back to where I started at the end of the 10 pulses. And somewhere along the line, I'm going to set the carry. Now, remember I said I want the real value to go out A and the complement to go out S. Now, the complement for each digit is going to be 9 minus the value in that digit. So basically, I've got 9 pulses. I want to send some of them out A and some of them out S. The carry tells me exactly when to switch from S to A. So for every one of the 10 pulses that goes in here, in between those pairs of 10, I've got one of these 9 pulses. And before the carry gets set, they're all going out the S port. And when the carry gets set, they start going out the A port. And that's basically how the machine worked. Here is kind of a rundown of an example I'm going to run through here. The accumulators I'm going to use in this example over here. I'm going to be loading up a number in this accumulator and then a different number in these two accumulators. And then we're going to output from here in a way that adds to this one and subtracts from this one. So that's what we're about to see happening. So I'll first of all click the init button. It takes a couple of add cycles before anything interesting happens, and now we get our first value in this one. That's the number 15. And if you've ever seen some of the newsreel footage of this, you may have seen this image where you've got these panels with
the ping pong balls.
Yeah, they look like ping pong. They are ping pong balls.
Yeah. They're ping pong balls. Yes.
Now, what's interesting, and I had not noticed this until Bill brought it to my attention, if you watch that carefully, you notice that the panel those ping pong balls are on is not part of the main machine. The machine's actually in the background in that video. I suspect that the thing that the ping pong balls were on was one of the prototypes that they had created in 43 as part of that 6-month contract.
I
don't know for sure.
What I had heard about the ping pong balls was that the ping pong balls, the cameraman came in to show,
right,
you know, to record the demo, and they couldn't, the lights
right
were not visible on, you know, the video. So they ran out and
right
went to the store and bought ping pong balls and then put them and
right
cut them out, and then that because they were glowing,
that's
then
right
they could. That was the reason I heard about the ping pong balls. That's
yes, that's the story behind how they came to be.
Yeah, the story about the ping pong balls.
So it was, you know, as usual for the press.
Yes.
So anyway, we've got 15 in here. Now, if anyone's colorblind, I apologize. I didn't realize that this would not show up to folks until one of my students said something the other night. He goes, "Is that doing anything?" It's like, "Yeah, these orange lights." He goes, "I'm colorblind." It's like, "I'm sorry."
Oh no.
The reason they're orange, by the way, is that's the color neon lights are. So this is basically simulating the neon lights. Okay. Another pulse is going to put the value of these two. I'm putting 27 in each of them. And right now I'm in that mode where single pushes will do one add time. I'm going to now switch to the mode where single pushes do one of the 100 kilohertz pulses. And we're going to start going through the function of it actually adding. Now, what has just happened here is we've just sent the first 10 P pulse into all of those digits, and they've all advanced up one spot. Now, we'll hit the 9P digit, which means that all of the things here, since none of the carries are on, will go out the S port, which means they'll all go over to this one. And this will continue happening until here, where I now set the carry, because this column is rolled over from 9 back to 0. Now what's going to happen is, instead of sending it to this one, that column will come over here, out the A port. And so these digits will all advance, and then this one will advance. Same thing continues to happen. Now the two columns are going to do the same thing. This is now wrapped around all 10 positions. So all of the carries are set. We're done with the 10 pulses. We've now got a carry here, and we've got two carries here, and we've got to resolve those. Well, that one's going to be pretty obvious. The carry here will just advance this up from the 3 position to the 4. Here to this carry, we'll cause that one to go up. This carry right here will ripple down all of those as they all go from 9 back to 0 and trigger the next one. And the other bit about this that you may not have noticed is, in the process, we've ended up with the negative sign being set over here, and that's one of the things that's going to get flipped by the carries. Whoops. Oh, I forgot that was that 1 prime P pulse for the 10's complement versus 9's complement. And then there's our final result there. And then we've got a couple more cycles for it to clear out the carries, and so now we've got 42 and 20, 12 over here, which are the results of 42 plus and minus 15. So that's how the bulk of the calculations in the machine were being done. Okay. This is a setup diagram to show you how programming was done. That's how you program that. This is ENIAC for A equals B plus C. The AS here indicates I'm sending both out the A and the S side. Those two data lines are going into the beta inputs of these two accumulators, so these are the programs that are reading them in. That, by the way, is the simulation specification for that bit of code, or sort of the relevant part of it, I should say. Yeah, need to move faster. You know, to cover 18,000 tubes in an hour, you've got to cover about 300 a minute. I'm way behind schedule. The multiplier. Neat thing about it is it uses multiplication tables. Good old second grade times tables. It literally has in it, if I'm multiplying 6 by 4, it's got a tens table that comes out as a 2, and a ones table that comes out as a 4. And I'm going to go through an example a little more quickly, hopefully, doing this calculation right here in the multiplier. So let me load up the multiplier wiring. And I'm sure that the real ENIAC people would have loved to be able to just point and click on which program they want to run. But, you know, instead, they took days, weeks to wire it. So here's what I'm going to start first. Now, this is loading in one of the two numbers. The other one's in an accumulator over here. You notice they're to the left. When using the multiplier, you tend to treat the numbers as fractions, that is, numbers less than 1, where the decimal point is on the left-hand side. So, now, this right here, if the first digit overall, the one we can't see is 4, that's a 3, so 4 times 3 is 12. Well, there's the 1 for the 12, and there's the 2. Then there's the 1 and the 6 for the 16 of 4 times 4, and the 2 and the 8 for the 28 of 4 times 7. Then that's adding in the next digit's worth, and now that adds the two together and gives us our final result. And so that's how the high-speed multiplier worked. Now, you'll notice I only went through a couple of steps there, and that's because I told it that my multiplier number only had two digits. You could actually select how many digits it had, and you could select the number of significant figures you were interested in, and it could even throw in a rounding value for you. Okay, everything up to this point was not terribly outside of the realm of what other people had thought about and were doing. For example, the way the accumulators were working, now certainly in terms of the cleverness of the tubes and the using the carry to switch A and S, that was pretty unique to this, but the idea of accumulating in the storage location was the same sort of thing going on at Harvard under Aiken's group. Even though Eckert and Mauchly were not aware of their work when they started, it was the same kind of approach. This part of it was not like what anybody else was doing. And in fact, this is the part that really made the ENIAC something different than the other machines. And in particular, it was the ability to do something conditional. You could do the typical if kind of a condition, or you could do what we would think of in Fortran as a computer go-to. And I'm going to illustrate the conditional here of the non-negative versus negative by showing you a little example of something that takes two numbers, compares them, and takes the larger of the two. And this, as I said, was the thing that really was different about this machine. So let me load that one up. Let me switch to the area where we're going to work. This tells you which position you're in of the 20 pulses that make up an adnot. So this is it running. Now, of course, the real one would look more like a blur. I haven't simulated the blurring. I just sample the state and display it periodically. Okay, so let's load up our two numbers. Whoops. Well, okay, it solved it already because I forgot to put it into one add mode. So it said, yeah, that's the bigger number. Let's try again. Go back into the one add mode. Okay, so now we've loaded the two numbers. We're going to pull the first one in, the number 123. We're going to subtract from it the number 456. We get a negative number. We're going to use that to control the programming of it. We're going to take the sign of this and feed it into one of the programming inputs. And that programming input then, that little neon light right there is what indicates that it's happened. And if you watch over here, the next step advances that by one. What happens is these have six positions. There are six individual programming outputs, one for each position. So they can select six different actions to be chosen. I've got it wired up so that one of the actions copies this number in, the other copies the other number. And there we are. It's loaded in the number 456, which is the larger of the two, because it was a negative result when subtracting. Because of time, I'm not going to illustrate what happens if I change the numbers and show that it, in fact, does the right thing. I do want to show you quickly, this is the setup for that. It's a little bit more involved than just adding and subtracting. And in particular, this bit right here, taking an output of a data trunk and feeding it into a control input, that's the bit that does this. And they had these adapters built up where you could plug them in and they would do things like shift all the numbers one digit position or another, delete some digits, or in this case, select one of the digit lines and turn it into a control signal. So during the course of reading out the A, if it's negative, you get 9 pulses out of here. If it's positive, you get 0 pulses. If any pulses go into this, then that triggers an action in this accumulator beginning at the next addition time. That action in this case is a no-op. These dummy programs for doing this kind of thing were documented in the very first documentation they had. And here's the output from it. So if this was negative, then we get an output here. If this was positive, we don't get an output here. And that's what triggers which one of these two we're going to get an output on. So you, this is how it could do conditional branching, which was something essentially nobody else could do except perhaps Zusa. Aiken's machine didn't do it. Stibitz's work didn't do it. This was very unique. And this by itself wasn't what really caught anybody's attention, but in retrospect, we realize now this is what made this machine Turing complete. It's a little bit more involved specification to set this one up. So I said the programming got changed a little bit at one point. And this was done in April of 1948. That date is actually kind of important because historically we've always thought it was August. And that was important because it was June of 1948 that the Manchester Baby first ran its code. Turns out that recently they've gone over the old operational logs of the ENIAC and discovered it was actually in April. The August date was somebody having asked someone who had been there when it was, and they said, I think it was August. And that just stuck. Everybody repeated it. And then when they went back to the logs, found out it was really April, which means that, depending on how you want to define it, the ENIAC ran in the form of an instruction set processor before the Manchester Baby. So one could argue that it was the first word program machine. And the way it was done is, they said, okay, I've got all these panels that are essentially building blocks that I wired together to solve a problem. Well, along the way, it was like, well, why don't we wire them together to be a CPU? And we'll read our instructions off of those panels of switches. And 1948 is when that switchover was done. And it was used in that form pretty much for the rest of its life. So they went from days and weeks of setup for each problem down to hours. Yeah, they lost the parallelism that Lemmer liked, but they made the human time more effective. And by the way, there were several different instruction set designs that were being discussed, and this is part of where von Neumann came into play. He was very interested in the instruction set side of things. And so he was involved in the discussions about to do this. In fact, one of the papers that talks about this conversion says, at such and such a point, von Neumann suggested to me that we do this. Now, this was well into the development of both the EDVAC at Penn and his IAS machine here. But I think as a result, he saw this as sort of a test bed to try out some of the ideas that were going to go into the machines that he was building. So as I said, that's how it ended up getting used. A few years later, they added more memory to it. You could finally have more than 20 variables. They added a 100-word core memory. Man, you had infinite memory now. Actually, it was interesting that very early on in their conversations, they actually talked about adding more accumulators that just didn't have the arithmetic capability. And they finally decided that the savings in equipment was not worth it. It was just as easy to go and make them full accumulators. And then later, the Ekamakali Computer Corporation submitted a proposal to add delay line memory to it. Ultimately, that wasn't accepted, but instead they bought it from Burroughs in 53, which of course, ironically, then merged with Sperry to become Unisys. And Sperry is where UMCC ended up. So that is a very quick look at the machine itself. Just a few notes about how the simulations are being done. The pictures you see here, this is not an actual photograph that was taken at the time. However, little bits and pieces of this image are photographs of the time. There was a lot of cutting and pasting. And what I did was, I cut and pasted in such a way that I built an image of each unit. And then wrote a ray tracer that I sort of programmed in the depth aspects to create the perspective view. And then that code also does the adding of the trays. So that's where the graphics come from. Let's see. Most of the rest of it's not terribly interesting unless you're just looking at how the code works. The interesting thing is kind of that it is being simulated pulse by pulse. So literally, if I'm transmitting a 5 from one accumulator to another, that's done by 5 messages in Go over Go channels. As a result, it's actually a little bit slower than the original. partly because I also have to have acknowledgement messages, because if I don't, things start crashing. And anyone who knows about concurrent programming knows exactly what I'm talking about. This is the URL, so you can write that down on your Trenton Computer Festival flyers. This is the URL where you can find both the simulator and the slides for the talk, and the plan is to post a link there as well to the video. Assuming the video goes as well as we hope it does. This is an experiment. So, here's a couple of other instances of the simulator running. One of them is this little kiosk that I've got here. I keep that in my office. Another is, if you want a pocket ENIAC, you can always buy one of these. Both of these are running on ARMs. This is running on Raspberry Pi. So, yeah. Okay, so, and this is the picture that Rebecca took of myself, Bill Mauchly, John's son, and Ted Nelson at the Vintage Computer Festival last year. So this is how I ended up here. So if you liked the talk, you can thank Rebecca. If you didn't like the talk, well, I'll take the blame. I was going to say to blame her. But yeah. Let it run while we're going. This is computing prime numbers. And it's doing that parallel sieve that Glemmer did.
Oh,
wow. So, questions?
Questions?
This one over there.
Yes.
Okay.
One of your early slides, you mentioned John von Neumann.
Yes.
And what was the context of that comment?
His involvement.
Did that have anything to do with the machine that he supervised here at the Princeton Institute for Advanced Study?
I believe that there's a relationship in that. I think he saw some of the potential of testing the ideas he was in the process of designing into that machine in the conversion of this one to the stored program model.
Yeah.
Now, he came into the game after the ENIAC was already designed and was under construction. And the way that happened was the Army liaison who was stationed at Aberdeen, named Herman Goldstein, was actually about to board a train headed for Philadelphia, where this was being built. And he happened to see von Neumann there on the train platform. And so he went and introduced himself. And, you know, von Neumann is being von Neumann, and you know, yeah. Oh, this was
in at the Institute for Advanced Study.
Yeah, he was at the Institute at the time.
The people who worked there called it the Johnny-Ack.
Yeah, well, there was a follow-on called the Johnny-Ack, yeah. But Goldstein was sort of explaining, okay, this is what we're working on. I'm working on this machine to do calculations. And von Neumann was kind of, yeah, didn't think too much about it until Goldstein said, yeah, and we can do about 5,000 multiplications a second and around 5,000 additions per second and 300 multiplications a second. And that got von Neumann's attention. Because he was also involved with the work going on at Los Alamos and knew what they needed in terms of computations. So later in 44, he got the clearance to come and talk with the folks on the project. By that time, Eckert and Mauchly were already starting to work on the follow-on machine, the EDVAC. And Eckert had already written a little description of what amounts to magnetic disks. And in it, he had just kind of as a little bit of an aside said, oh yeah, and the programming can be put on here. Now, what I think happened then is, von Neumann being here, he knew Alonzo Church, he knew Kurt Gödel, And I'm pretty sure he knew Alan Turing, because Alan Turing came here to do his PhD.
Right, to do his PhD.
After he wrote the paper that would have been a career paper for any of us.
Right.
He didn't have his PhD yet when he wrote that paper. This result was this obscure little thing in mathematics that almost nobody knew anything about, but von Neumann would have known about it. And would have been aware of the little extra proof kind of in the middle of the paper that said, oh yeah, I can create this universal version of this. And I think when von Neumann gets to Penn, starts talking with them, sees what they're talking about, he realizes this could be a realization of that universal machine. And if you read anybody's account, the thing they always say about von Neumann is he was really focused on the instruction set. And I believe the reason was he was trying to make sure that he would make sure that whatever got designed, that instruction set would be sufficient to provide the universality that Turing proved in the paper. Eventually, everybody realized it didn't take very much. Almost anything will do it, as long as you've got some kind of conditional branching. In fact, in one of his preliminary discussions about the IAS machine, they kind of make a statement that says, yeah, now that we figured out that almost anything will be sufficiently general, our primary interest in the instructions is efficiency. So I think, my opinion is that's how he really fits into that whole picture. Is that he's the one who was able to see the connection between this obscure mathematical result that almost nobody in the world knew about and these practical techniques for doing calculation and realize that they actually fit together. And the only other person who was likely to see that was Turing himself, which of course he was also seeing in England. Yeah.
What did Turing know about the ENIAC?
As I recall, very little. Now, he did visit the US a couple of times during the war, but primarily in relation to code-breaking activities. He spent a little time over here at Bell Labs, actually, in, I guess the best way to describe it is reviewing the work that was being done there on voice encryption. Essentially, in the US at Bell Labs, they developed a scheme for encrypting voice so that Churchill and Roosevelt could have a secure conversation. And, you know, then the Americans go to the British and say, we've got this, please install this piece of equipment. And the British are thinking, wait a minute, this is a war and you're asking us to install this piece of equipment we've never seen before. And so they send Turing to go check it out. But as far as I know, he was not familiar with the ENIAC during the war. Now, what he did do was, because he was at Bletchley Park and they were developing the Colossus there, he saw in the Colossus that, I could actually build one of those things I wrote about in the paper. And started thinking along those lines. And then when he left Bletchley Park, he went to the National Physical Laboratory and started working on the ACE. Yes?
I guess in Hidden Figures, there's still email computers. So that's like 15 years later. So
yes.
I'm trying to figure out why it's still there.
Honestly, I'm not sure if their usage of that term is entirely historically correct. It was my understanding before seeing the movie that by that time the term computer had gone out of use as a job title and had become synonymous with an electronic computer. Up until, certainly until the 1940s, it was a job title. If
but
you look at a dictionary.
But it was during the ENIAC too, because the women who worked on it, that
right.
was their job title.
Yes,
and
a number
and
of them.
And then they got, but they were originally doing
exactly.
differential equations, but then some of them got transferred to doing the patch base.
This is part of why the ENIAC contract, Penn was able to pick it up so easily. They were already cooperating with Aberdeen in doing these calculations.
Right, they were doing the differential equations.
There were a differential analyzer both at Penn and at Aberdeen. And they both had staffs of people doing the work. And their job title was computer. And because so many of the men had been drafted and gone overseas, all of the women who had graduated in math were pulled into it.
But there's a little history with from Digital Equipment about that. Ken Olson didn't sell computers.
Right.
He sold programmable data processors.
Right.
And it was a coding for that at the government. There was a title and a coding, and they weren't allowed to purchase computers.
Mm-hmm.
They were allowed to purchase programmable data processors.
Now, maybe you can confirm or deny this. I've also heard that there was some hesitance on the part of his backers, of his funders, to pay for a computer company. And so that's why the first set of products were the system modules, not the whole systems. But they had designed the set of system modules they would sell to be exactly the parts they needed to build computers. I don't know for sure if that's true, but that's one of the stories that I had heard. Yes? Yes. It was, and I forget which classification it had, but it did have one of the secret classifications. And it was at that point in 1946 that they made the decision to make it public and to remove most of the classification. I believe the deal was that some of the circuit designs were still classified, but the overall machine wasn't anymore. Yes?
Could you put your URL back, please?
Oh, sure. Okay.
Thank you.
Just have to learn how to use my own software. Any other questions? Yes?
Who was doing the coding? How were they learning the coding?
The hard way. Okay, here's the way that story goes. Remember we mentioned all the women who were hired to do the calculations. A subset of them were pulled into the project. And the idea was, if the primary thing this is going to do is calculate the same things that they're calculating by hand, they're going to know how to operate it. So they were brought in primarily as operators. Now here's the thing, the mindset at the time was, the hard part's going to be figuring out how to build a machine that can do this. We already know how to write down equations. We'll just write down the equations, put them into the machine. The idea that programming would be hard never entered into anyone's mind. So they designate these people to be operators. And the idea was that someone would go and do one of these diagrams, like this one right here, and then somebody would stand out in the room and call off plug numbers and switch positions, and you would have six or eight people standing around the machine, each taking orders, plugging in cables and dialing in switches. Mm. Well, somewhere along the line, though, somebody had to figure out how to write these diagrams. And the presumption was that the operators would figure this out for them, for the mathematicians. Well, nobody showed them anything. So they sat down with the engineers to understand how the machine worked and figure out how all of this took place. And in fact, that was the source of one of the primary technical manuals that was part of the documentation handed over by Penn. Adele Goldstein, Herman Goldstein's wife, wrote the technical manual that describes how to go about doing all of this. And in later years, she described the programming difficulties of it in slightly uncomplimentary terms. Considering that this may end up on YouTube, I don't want to say it.
Does that document still exist at Penn?
Yes. Yeah. As a matter of fact, it has recently, well, I don't know how recently it is, but it has been republished, and you can actually go and purchase it. And this is a copy of it. And part of the reason that it's kind of bent up and dog-eared is, this was my primary reference in writing the simulator.
Wow.
Now this was the first volume of the technical manual. The second volume of the technical manual was all about the internal circuitry. Okay. Then there was also this operating manual that was part of it. The circuitry one has not been republished in a nice bound form, but you can get it on archive.org.
Nice.
Yes?
I think it might be important to note that Adela was writing that manual simultaneously as the girls were programming.
Mm-hmm.
They never saw the manual. They
right.
had to sit down with block diagrams and just figure out how to program it. And by the time they were all done and had it mastered, Adela was done writing the manual.
Right.
Wow.
And then it was about time for the machine to move to Aberdeen. And several of them left the project and didn't go to Aberdeen with it. Including your mom, if I remember right, right?
I'm sorry?
Your mom was one of the ones who stayed behind and didn't go to Aberdeen.
She went to Aberdeen.
Oh, did she? She didn't go to Aberdeen.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is Jenny Mockley. Her mom was one of the programmers. Any other questions? Going once, going twice.
Okay.
Well, oh,
just a comment. The book by Walter Isaacson called The Innovators
yeah.
like that is really great with regard to the role of the programmers and who did it and who really worked hard but didn't really get any fundamental credit until very much later.
Yeah, the story of the has only recently really become well told. There's a documentary that was produced by one of the faculty at Temple that's not specifically about the programmers per se, but about all of the women computers who were working in that. And the title of that is called Top Secret Rosies. I keep intending to see, I've yet to see it, but from what I hear, it's good. So you should all go see it.
So, just a few short questions. So, the simulator that's running, it seems to have stopped calculating, but it's
yes.
still doing its numbers on the side. Was there, so it's, that's the clocks over there?
Right, that's the clock over there on the left.
But it's finished, so
right.
it knows that.
And I set it up to stop at this point because it's only checking factors up to 47, I think. And if I go beyond this, I start ending up actually including a few composite numbers.
Okay.
Now, when Lemmer did this, he filtered that out by hand.
Okay.
Because he was doing more than just generating prime numbers. He was then going on and doing some stuff with them, and there were relatively few instances that slipped through.
Okay.
But I didn't want to run a demo that then would pop up a nice composite number that somebody would go, wait a minute, that's
yeah,
not prime.
So the chunks that are there at UPenn right now,
mm-hmm.
definitely the oscilloscope part.
Right.
And what else is
there? They have currently the cycling unit, one panel of the master programmer,
okay.
one panel of a function table, and an accumulator.
Okay. And then they got it working for the anniversary, for the 50th anniversary.
Yes, I'm not
I
sure exactly to what extent or how.
Oh, I could tell you what the only thing that it did was it added the numbers 19 and 46 together. And Al Gore, who didn't invent the ENIAC, he pushed the button to just get it to do the addition. And most of us were not allowed to be anywhere near what
mm-hmm.
was happening, the grad students. And so we were shoved off in other rooms. But the sniffer dogs did come through and sniff out all of our lockers before Al Gore showed up. But
make
that
sure
was
there was
all
nothing wrong in the tubes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But that was all it did. And I assume it's still wired to do that. I guess I was going to ask you if you knew what they wired to do it, but maybe you didn't.
I have honestly not looked at it that closely
okay.
to try to infer what the wiring on it currently is.
Okay, but that is what it did. It only did that one calculation.
It makes me wonder how much of it was actually working then.
Yeah.
Correct.
You know, like
correct.
You would only need a couple of digits in each of the accumulator. But as you only have one accumulator, so I'm trying to think. I'd have to see the...
Just go back there and...
Yeah,
I'd
have to take a look at a video
yeah,
of it or something, yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
What panel was at the Smithsonian some years back?
Correct.
They had most of it, actually.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And in fact, the largest single collection of pieces is in the Smithsonian storage.
Mm. Yeah.
At one time, they had a lot of it set up as a sort of walk-through part of their exhibit.
Right.
Mm. and then they rotated that out, put it back into storage, and most of the units are in storage at Smithsonian.
It's in Malone. You go into the Moore School.
A few units. I think there's one on display, and I think they may have one in storage at the Computer History Museum in California. There's a unit or two at the University of Michigan, which is where Arthur Burks went back to after working in the world. There's a section of, I think, about six units that are on display in an Army museum in Oklahoma.
Huh.
Now, that group of units is there because at some point Ross Perot found out that the ENIAC was out in storage in the back hinterlands of Aberdeen.
Yeah.
And said, oh, I've got to rescue this stuff.
Right.
So he uses some of his Army contacts, gets some chunks of it, sets it up in his headquarters, only they don't restore it. They just put some flashing lights in it. And since then, that part of it has been given back to the Army, and they've got it on display in Oklahoma.
Okay.
Those are the main parts that I know of their locations. As I said, as far as I'm concerned, the right thing to do is to bring it all back to Philadelphia, put it back together, and make it work.
All right. Thank you.